Good morning, students. Once again, welcome back to Economics Online class conducted by APA Public School. So today we are going with the topic terms of credit. Before that, we have to recollect what we discussed in the previous classes. So in this lesson, we discuss why money is considered as medium of exchange and how the bank work in between depositor and borrower. So later we discuss what are the different services provided by bank. So we detailed discuss what is demand deposit, its advantages and disadvantages, check its advantages and disadvantages, on what conditions check are written by the bank, that is discounted and bounced check. Then later we started to discuss credit. We understood that credit is a situation in which the lender give the money or goods and services to the borrower on condition that in the future they will repay with the interest, principal amount with the interest. So simply we can say that credit is a loan. Credit is a loan. We are using the money of someone else now and on condition that we will pay later. So today we are going with this topic, that is terms of credit. So we know that getting loan is not an easy matter. It is very risky. Getting loan from bank, it will take time. So what are the conditions are necessary to get credit from bank? So we can explain this topic with the help of an example. Megha, according to your textbook, this example is given. Megha, she is one self-reliant woman and she got 3 hectares of land according to the division of parental property. So she decided to construct one house on this 3 hectares of land. 3 hectares of land, but she did not have the money. So she thought about how to get a credit from bank. So she consulted with the bank. Bank, they are ready to grant loan to Megha, but on conditions. She want to get a 10 lakh rupee loan. 10 lakh. This is the principal amount she demanded as credit. So for this 10 lakh rupees, bank instructed her that she want to submit certain records, that is land ownership record. Land ownership means which land that is owned by Megha, and on the condition that she will pay interest rate, that is 10% per year, but on monthly installment along with the bank demanded salary certificate, salary, human security. So mainly when bank ready to given the credit 10 lakh rupee to Megha, bank demanded land ownership certificate. Second one, she want to accept the interest rate 10% a year, but how to pay annual, means monthly installment. Then her salary certificate and 2 human security, and these all are together called terms of credit. Terms of credit means every loan activities they are providing with the help of certain documentation, certain need for certain documentation. And documentations are mainly ownership certificate or the salary certificate, whatever she have, she want to give us security. Along with this, she want to accept the interest rate and she want to accept monthly installment according to this interest rate, and there is a need for 2 human security to suppose if anything happened to Megha, means she is not ready to pay, so she is run from the particular place, then somebody want to give the security for that money. So these all terms and conditions are very necessary to provide the terms of them provide to get the credit. So these all are together called terms of credit. So terms of credit definition you have to write. Terms of credit means what are the conditions or requirements are necessary to get a loan from formal sectors, they are called terms of credit. And another example, what are the sources of credit that are given in your textbook? There is varieties of credit arrangement. There are four examples given. First case is Shamla. He is one agriculture labor. For cultivating his field, he got credit from the nearest land owner at a percentage interest rate percentage 60% interest rate per month, and he got a loan from the landowner. That is the first case. And second case is given about Arun. Arun got a loan from money lender. Money lender is the person, he is profession is lending money for industry. So their percentage of interest rate, a landowner 60%, money lender 60%. And another one example given, that's the case of Ramu. In the case of Ramu, he got a loan from his own landowner for buying certain agriculture inputs. So here, again, landowner, but he given the loan at 10% because Ramu know him very personally and Ramu is working in this landowner's field. So see here, first one landowner, he did not know Shamla, that's why he imposed 60% of interest rate. But second case, the money lender, he is the professional, he is giving the money for industry only, it's a 60%. But say third case, the landowner even credited to Ramu at 10% because they know each other. And another one, people, many people in villages, they are taking loan from bank, particularly cooperative bank, Grameen bank, and some other NGOs, non-governmental organization, NGOs. They're also providing micro credit to the people, those who are necessary for those who they need loan. So here see, landowner, money lender, then again landowner, then bank, cooperative, then Grameen bank, then another NGOs. And sometimes whenever we need money, we are getting money from our friends, relatives, our neighborhood, they are also the part of credit. So on the basis of these examples, we have to categorize what are the two main sources of credit. The two main sources of credit, first one is called a formal sector. And some other examples, say friends, then neighbors, relatives. From them also, whenever we need money in emergency, we are getting. So that's why we can add them also the part of sectors of credit or sources of credit. Sources of credit mainly classified into two, formal and informal sectors of credit. There are two sources of credit, formal and the informal sectors of credit. Now you want to know that what are the differences between formal and informal sectors of credit. See here, for getting money from friends, neighbor, relative, we do not want to submit any security. That is, we do not want to submit to collateral. Collateral means any documentation related to how much property we have, including maybe vehicle details, land details, maybe livestock. These all are the part of a collateral. The terms of condition collateral is very mandatory. But from getting loan from friends, neighbors, relatives, or from money lender, we do not want to submit any security. So under this informal sector, collateral is not mandatory. Collateral is not mandatory. But in the case of a bank, if we want to get the loan from bank, we have to submit all the terms and conditions according to the credit. terms and conditions including documentation, then the installment, we have to accept what installment we will pay and what is the interest rate, everything we have to accept. So in from getting loan from formal sectors, collateral is mandatory. That is the main differences between the formal and the informal sectors of credit. In formal sector, for getting credit, collateral is mandatory, but in informal sector, collateral is not mandatory, because informal sectors, the friends, neighbors, relatives, or the money lender, they from the same locality, they know each other. But in bank, bank is an institution, not a private individual. So your personal interaction, by personal knowing, is not a matter. So that's why for getting loan from formal sector, collateral is mandatory. And all the formal sectors are registered under the government, registered and follows rules and regulation. All the banks are registered under Bank of Bengal. Bank of Bengal, we know that RBI. RBI supervises, monitor and instructs how much amount of money have to be lent, what is the interest rate, and what is the time of or duration of payment. Everything is supervised by or controlled by or monitored by RBI bank. That's why we can say that formal sectors or formal sources of credit are the sources of credit which are registered under the government and follows rules and regulation. So what are the rules and regulation they are following? First one, rules regarding interest rate. Interest rate. Interest rate may be vary from loan to loan, not from person to person. 3.5% to maximum 20 or 23% of interest. And any person, those who know the manager of the bank, he is not going to get the loan at a different rate. So what are the loan activities are there? Those who are getting the credit, they have to pay the same interest rate. It means fixed interest rate. That is absent in informal sector. Here, the example I told, then for example 1 and example 3, both are the landowners. First one, he did not know the borrower, and that's why he did not given the interest credit at a very low interest rate. Here 60%. But the third case, Ramu know his landowner very well and Ramu worked in his field. That's why he given the interest credit at the interest rate 10%. That type of a concession is not available in formal sectors. Then another one, already told the collateral is mandatory. It have to be registered. And they are following rules and regulations regarding the interest rate, and not only that, duration of payment. Duration of payment. So all the formal sectors are lending loan on the condition of duration of payment. A duration not 1 month, 2 months. Most of the bank they are providing from 11 month to, that is 1 year. 11 month to maximum 30 years loan they are providing. Particularly house construction loan, then land occupation loan, that land occupying, that is therefore also loan are available. They are maximum 30 years they are providing. But the money lenders or the people, those who are the part of the informal sector, they do not have any fixed duration. Maybe they will lend for 1 month or 2 months. But whenever they ask, we have to give. Means the borrower have to return the payment with the interest rate. And the interest rate is here very low. Already I told interest rate is fixed. Not only that, comparing with the formal informal sectors, interest rate is low. Low interest rate. And another one, another important feature of informal sector, suppose a person, he took a loan from the formal sector, from any bank, without paying the first earlier loan, he is not eligible to get the second loan. If we have any loan that is credited in the bank, first we have to pay with the principal amount and the interest. When it will be complete, all the formality will close, then only we are eligible to get the second loan. Then also we have to wait for a long time. But in informal sectors, without paying the first earlier loan, the borrower can get the second loan. If it is necessary, he can get the loan again without paying the earlier. But the difference is that here no rules and regulation. That's why most of the informal cases, particularly money lenders, certain blade mafias are there. Blade mafia means they are giving money for high interest rate. Timely, they are not paying. Means the borrower not paying, they are using different illegal or unfair means to get their loan back. So that is why we can say that the main or most important feature of the informal sector is higher cost of borrowing. So I'm repeating what are the differences between formal and informal sectors of credit. The sources of credit are divided into two: formal and informal sectors. Formal sector means the sector which is registered under the government, RBI. RBI is monitoring. You can say that RBI is monitoring, then controlling, instructing, and supervising all the banks how to lend the loan and what are the terms and conditions they have to follow, and which are the documentations are necessary, and how much time can give. All the decisions are taken by RBI. So we can say that formal sectors are supervised by RBI, but such a type of organization is absent in the case of informal sectors. Then again, collateral is mandatory in formal sector. Without collateral, the bank will not provide loan. Why collateral is compulsory or why it is mandatory? Suppose if the borrower failed to repay the loan, the seller, that is the lender, has the right to sell the asset and get their payment. So that is the reason why they are demanding collateral. Suppose without collateral, if they lend, if they not repaid, also they failed to repay, it will be a loss for the bank. So bank is an intermediary institution. No, bank using the money of someone, that is depositors' money. So whenever depositors are demanded, they have to repay the money. So that is why bank never lend loan without collateral. But in the case of informal sector, collateral is not mandatory. And another one, they are following informal sectors are registered and follow rules and regulation. The rules regarding what is the interest rate, that is fixed for everyone, not to change person to person. And it specifies the duration of payment, and the interest rate is always low comparing with the informal sector. And RBI is the controller, monitor, and instructing and supervising the bank how to lend, how much they have to lend, what are the registers they have to follow, everything decided by or they controlled by RBI. But informal sectors are the sectors of credit. The collateral is not mandatory and there is no rules and regulation. That's why interest rate vary from person to person. Duration, everything is depend on the means of the lender. And the interest rate is comparing with the formal sector is very high, and RBI, like none of the agency is here to supervise. That's why the informal sectors sometimes they follow illegal or unfair means to get the money back. So that's why we can say that higher cost of borrowing is the most important disadvantage or the feature of informal sectors of credit. So now we want to know what is higher cost of borrowing. Higher cost of borrowing means two main implications. The first one, higher cost of borrowing. So in the last class we discussed the case of Lakshmi. Lakshmi took 5,000 rupees loan at the interest rate 10% for 3 months. So at the end of the month, she want to pay 6,500. Just think that after getting the 5,000 rupees loan, so at the end of the harvesting, she got 7,000 rupees. How much she want to pay as interest rate and principal amount? Principal amount of 5,000 and 10% into 3 months, that is 1,500. Total 6,500 she want to pay. See, she got only 7,000. So from the 7,000, 6,500 want to pay us the interest rate and the principal amount, means the credit. Only 500 left with her. It means higher cost of borrowing sometimes only sometimes create only few income left with the borrower because of the repayment. This is the first one. And the second case, the same 5,000 she earn at rupees 10% for 3 months because the crops affected because of the climate or the pasture. That is why in the first 3 months not able to pay. So after 6 months if she pay, 6 months instead of 3, so she want to pay 5,000 plus 6 × 5, again 3,000, total 8,000. Here if she get 7,000 only, she want to pay 8,000 rupees, 1,000 rupees more than what she get. So this is the second case. Higher cost of borrowing sometimes push the people to repay the principal amount with the interest rate. How much she is getting, then most of the larger part of their earnings they have to give us the credit, means the interest rate and the principal amount. But in certain cases, higher cost of the borrowing means they have to pay how much they received more than that. Here she received only 5,000, but here 8,000 want to pay. Suppose if it extend 1 year, 1 year means almost 12 months. 12 months means she want to pay 6,000 plus the principal amount of 5,000. You see, only 5,000 received, but she want to pay 6,000 as interest rate. So this is the second meaning of a higher cost of borrowing. So higher cost of borrowing, again I'm repeating, means first one, larger part of the earning they have to repay. Larger part of their earning they have to repay. That's why only few income left with them. Second case, sometimes they have to pay more than how much they received. That is the second implication of the higher cost of borrowing. So now we are going to the next topic. See, here because of the informal sector, because of the high interest rate in the informal sectors, the people have to pay high cost of borrowing. We want to know that in society, who is getting loan from formal and the informal sectors? We can divide society into four categories. First category is very poor. Very poor means people, they do not have an income to survive or they do not have any facilities. And second one, people with a little income, little asset. And third one, people, they are well off. And last category is rich people, they are rich. So we can avoid the first, the second and the third category. We can compare the life situation or credit situation. So for the first and last, very poor and rich, who is receiving credit from formal and the informal sectors? First take the case of very poor. They do not have any collateral. They do not have own land. And the second one, most of the poor people are illiterate. They do not know, otherwise we can say that they are less educated. They do not know what are the schemes are available in the bank and what are the subsidy rate or what interest they have to pay. Nothing they do not know, because they do not know the schemes of the bank, because none of the bank officials are going to meet the poor people and then inviting to get the loan from bank. And next one is getting loan from bank. It is very difficult for the poor people because banks are far away from villages. Banks are not available everywhere. Collateral is mandatory. They do not have a collateral. Second one, formalities and schemes much difficult, risk and difficult for the poor people. And another one, very poor people, they not need a loan like a crores of rupees or lakh of rupees. Like Vijayamalya, like many people, they took a crores of rupees from the bank. Like poor people, they do not need. Maybe they needed 200 rupees or 500 rupees or more than that, or 300, 3,000, 3,000, not more than that. Because how much they will borrow from others, they are thinking that how they will pay. So that is why poor people, they do not need more money That's why they always depend on the informal sectors, because neighbor, landowner or moneylender, they know each other. Whenever they need, they will provide money without any condition, without any terms of credit. There is no need of a documentation, and there is no need to pay within that time limit. So certain conditions are absent in informal sectors. Not only that, if it is necessary, they can get the loan without paying the area loan. So that is the poor people are dependent upon the informal sector. But the richer people, they are not facing such a kind of problems. They have enough amount of collateral, land and other properties, certificates they have. And rich people, mainly they are living in the city region, or otherwise they know, they are educated, they know the conditions of a bank or what are the schemes that are available in the bank. So that's why they are getting more loan from the formal sector than informal sector. And at the same time, banks are available, different branches of the banks are available in city region. And another one, rich people are more dependent upon the informal sectors than informal sectors. That's why 90% of the rich people depend on formal sectors, that is bank, and 85% of the poor people, they are depend on the informal sectors of credit. But we know that in informal sector, people have to pay higher cost of borrowing. Sometimes they are not able to pay, they are facing the debt trap. In the case of Lakshmi, we understood that. But in certain cases, we know that the people, those who are not able to pay the money, they are committing suicide. So we have to protect the people, those who are getting loan from informal sectors. Otherwise, we have to reduce the domination of money lender or the other people, those who are lending money for higher interest rate. So we can say that cheap and affordable credit is very crucial for the country's development. Not only country's development, people's standard of life want to improve, or otherwise they want to free from the domination of money lender. Suppose they do not want to pay the higher cost of borrowing, money is left with them. It can help them to increase their per capita income, it can accelerate their economy, or whatever the other things they want to buy. If they want to invest in agriculture or in any small business, or they have to set a cottage industry or small scale industry, they can invest in that way, they can change their life. That's why we can say that cheap and affordable credit is very necessary for overall development of the country. People's development, society's development and national development need cheap and affordable credit. But the main problem of giving credit is collateral is mandatory. Same time, bank have to follow rules and regulation, but bank have to lend the money, because RBI already instructed that not only the motive, means the profit is not only the motive of the bank. Bank have to lend money for the society's welfare. But without collateral, it is not possible. So that is why RBI and some economists together introduce a new concept or new method of lending loan, that is the creation of SSG. SSG means self-help group, Swayam Sahaya Samuga. So that is our next topic. What is SSG? And what are the conditions or to get a loan to SSG? Also, what are the benefits of SSG in rural development? Okay, first, SSG introduced in India in 1980s. Before that, in 1975, the formation of SSG first introduced in Bangladesh by Muhammad Yunus. These are the topics not in your textbook. So in 1975, Muhammad Yunus, he was one of the economist and banker, and he introduced a new concept, microfinance. Microfinance means how to distribute small income to the people, those who are needy, and how to get it back. So that idea created, that is SSG, self-help groups, Swayam Sahaya Samuha. Swayam, that is the self-help group. That idea introduced by Muhammad Yunus in Bangladesh, Grameen Bank of Bangladesh. And later, it introduced in India first in Karnataka. Karnataka, the name of the first SHG is Mairatha. Mairatha, Mysore Resettlement and Development Agreement. This is Resettlement Association. This is the first SHG formed in India in Karnataka. So now almost 2.2 million SHGs are available in India, and more than 33 million women and men are working in SHG. SHG is a small association financial committee formed by the people between 10 to 20. It consists of 10 to 20 members from the same neighborhood. It can be formed by male or female, but their eligibility or age is fixed. That age, minimum 18 they have to complete, not exceed 40. This is the age limit. They can form a sangam or the self-help group. So when they are forming sangam, they have to register with one particular name, like Aishwarya Swayam Sahaya Sangha, Aishwarya SHG, or whatever the name the committee, the group they like, they can keep. So after 2-3 years, means when they will form, 2-3 years they have to work, they have to collect a minimum amount that depend upon the sangam, how much they can collect according to their income. They can collect minimum 20 to 100 or 200 rupees they can collect weekly or monthly. And from this sangam, they select one president and one secretary and one book maintainer, that is a book for maintaining the book, one book maintainer also there. So these three manage all the activities of SHG. When they have to meet, how much amount of money they have to collect, and what are the terms and conditions of giving credit to the people, means among the members, everything decided by the SHG only. And this SHG, when they become eligible to get the loan, means after 2-3 years, they definitely have a minimum amount, one good amount they have. That the collected amount with this registered name, they will need to bank and request for credit. So on the conditions of the fixed amount, that how much they collected, that they will sell it as a security or the collateral. The bank will lend the loan. This money, how much they are getting from the loan, means from the bank, they can use for their purposes, like for buying a sewing machine, or anybody want to invest in their children's education, or they have to buy ornaments or whatever they need, they can use. But they have to return with the interest rate. That interest rate is always very less than what the money lender charges. So it will help the women, particularly in rural women, to become self-reliant. Certain sanghams in India, they started cottage industries with the help of the money that they got as a credit from bank. For example, cottage industries of achar powder making, pickle powder, or other is a soap making, then sip up like your tube ice that they are making with the help of this money. Like they are earning certain income from the SHG. And not only that, the most important contribution of SHG is they, when the women or men, they are sitting together, they definitely will discuss about the problems of the society. If that is women, they will discuss about the problem what they are facing in their family or in society, particularly related to health issues, or the domestic violence, harassment, otherwise what are the other social issues that affect their life. So this is the reason why many SHGs group, particularly in the state of Andhra Pradesh, Bihar, and then Maharashtra, SHGs took the initiative to ban the use of drugs, particularly alcohol, selling and buying of alcohol banned in then Bihar, and in then particularly anti-liquor movement of Andhra Pradesh led by the SHG only. And you know that now in Maharashtra, selling and buying of gutka, panbirag and other items, any like items, that is totally banned because of the contribution or because of the movement that led by the SHG. So now we are summarizing what is SHG. The concept of SHG first introduced by an economist, banker of Bangladesh, his name Muhammad Yunus, and he started microfinance system through SHG. SHG means self-help group. Because according to the terms of creditor, without collateral, banks are not ready to lend loan. But without a collateral, it have to be lent because most of the poor people are under the domination of the money lender. Money lenders are still, we can say that still, poor people, particularly in rural area, 90% of the people are depending on the informal sectors of credit. The reasons banks are not available everywhere and getting loan from bank, it is very difficult. Poor people, they do not know what are the schemes are going there or what are the subsidy rate or interest rate. They are far away from the banking schemes. And not only that, getting loan is very risky because documentation required and they have to accept all the terms and conditions. Collateral is mandatory. Apart from that, bank is not ready to give the loan on personal knowing each other because banks are not an individual, it is an organization. But another one, without paying the prior loan, first loan, early loan, the people are not getting the second loan from the bank. That is why most of the poor people are dependent upon the informal sectors of credit. Higher cost of borrowing something push them into debt trap, but most of the time they are facing the difficult situation in their life. They are committing to suicide for protecting the poor people from the domination of money lenders or the informal sectors of credit and their unfair means. Government of India, along with certain NGOs, started the concept SHG. In India, first SHG is started in Karnataka. It says MyRedha. MyRedha means Mysore Resettlement and Development Association. So this is the first SHG formed in India. Now almost 2.2 million SHGs are working. And it consists of 33 million of people. So certain eligibilities are necessary to form SHG. SHG is an association consists of minimum 10 to 20 members between the age group 18 to 40. And they have to meet regularly. They have to collect some amount of money according to their capability, maybe to 20 or 100 rupees. And this amount they will collect minimum 2-3 years. After the successful working of 2-3 years, when they will get in way, collect a good amount, that amount, with that amount and registered name, the president, secretary and other members will reach to the bank to get the loan. The bank provide loan to the SHG, not to individual. But when they receive a loan, they can distribute among themselves. That money they can use for personal use, otherwise they can invest to start a new firm. Like making different garam masala powder or achar powder, pickle powder, making company or soap making, or sometimes they can buy the cloth at low price where it's a wholesale market. They can sell in the local area. And like nighty, sari, these items are available in wholesale market at very less price. They can sell to the local area in their own villages. Those who are neighbors, they can sell it little higher than from where they go. So in that way, they will work minimum two or three years, when they become eligible, they get a loan. So here, all the decisions regarding when they will meet, how much amount of money they have to get from bank, or how to distribute, what they have to do with that money. Suppose one person not ready to pay the money, then all the members are responsible. So they will select the member like those who are ready to pay and those who are loyal. So that type of a paper only selected in this particular group. All the decision regarding how much money they have to collect and all then what is the interest rate and how to distribute, when they have to meet, who want to become the president, the secretary, every decisions are taken by the members only. And these are the reasons why we can say that the SHGs are the building block of rural India. And it help the problem, it helps the women to empower because when they are sit together, they will discuss the problems related to health, nutrition, particularly harassment, home violences. They will discuss and they will take the solution. And apart from these, the SHG, creation of SHG, help the bank to lend the loan without collateral. So it helped to overcome the problem of lack of collateral. And that's why you can say that with the help of SHG, women can become self-reliant. So these are the advantages of SHG. So these are the main topic in chapter money and the creditor. So chapter almost finish. If you have any doubt regarding the chapter from first to end, then please log in FCC at 5:30. Thank you.